funciona l'anàlisi textual en antiracist feminist action research, en una recerca acció antiracista i feminista. Crec que és important que aquesta sessió ens centrem en el tema de l'anàlisi del discurs. L'anàlisi del discurs, de la qual la doctora Erika Bachmann és una reconeguda especialista, és un camp que, a l'entendre de les persones que vam organitzar aquest seminari, és clau a l'hora d'entretar-nos al que és el camp de la metodologia en passat de feminista. Erika és una reconeguda especialista en aquest camp. Ella, un dels seus treballs més reconeguts, un dels seus primers camps d'estudi, va ser en l'àmbit de la psicologia evolutiva. I un dels seus treballs que va ser publicat també a l'estat espanyol és una deconstrucció pròpiament del que són els conceptes mainstreaming de com seria entès la psicologia evolutiva, la psicologia d'infant. Posteriorment, doncs, en el seu treball dins l'àmbit d'anàlisi del discurs, ha seguit treballant dins l'àmbit de la psicologia feminista i actualment també dins el que serien els estudis multiculturals, dels quals el que són els papers que ens ha passat doncs, serien una bona mostra del que són les seves actuals investigacions dins aquest àmbit, un àmbit d'entreuament del que seria les diferents cultures, en el que seria el divide, el que seria l'eix de gènere. Perquè Erika és docent al Departament de Psicologia i Canvi Social de la MMU, de la Universitat Metropolitana de Manchester. I ella també allà dinamitza el que és la discurs únic, que ha sigut un dels espais de debat i de recerca que ha tingut una gran rellevància des del que estaria pensant l'àmbit d'estudis del discurs. Tornem una mica a la pregunta inicial de per què hem volgut treure aquest anàlisi en una sessió sobre l'anàlisi del discurs, quina importància té el discurs dins del que seria la metodologia feminista. Quan vam treballar la primera sessió amb Bàrbara sobre epistemologia feminista, quan hem abordat posteriorment qüestions vinculades a l'etnografia, quan hem treballat sobre fonts estadístiques, sobre la geografia feminista, quan hem abordat altres àmbits, en el fons, en certa manera, ja estàvem vorejant el que és l'anàlisi del discurs, en certa manera, el que estàvem fent és un primer distanciament, un primer anàlisi del que seria el discurs de la ciència positivista, el discurs de l'altre, el discurs que pot anar a les fonts numèriques. El discurs, en certa manera, importa. I en aquest sentit, doncs, nosaltres, d'una manera potser molts cops no conscient, d'una manera, doncs, diguéssim, sense tenir plenament consciència del que estem fent, ja som, en certa manera, analistes del discurs. El que canvia quan nosaltres plantegem aquest camp d'anàlisi del discurs és la introducció d'un seguit d'eines, d'un seguit, doncs, de les treses que ens han nascut dins el que seria aquest àmbit i que ens poden ajudar-nos doncs, a aconseguir un major rendiment, una major qualitat en el que seria la nostra recerca. És allò, òbviament, un discurs
allow us to develop on a critical vision. Just a bit about, as an introduction to this field, for those who might not be familiar with it, within linguistics, these would be discourse studies, is something that's come up rather.
Posteriorment, doncs, a partir de dues tradicions, una és entre la lingüística i les dogmàtiques, i una, al meu entendre, podem mirar la lingüística és important per entendre el que seria l'anàlisi del discurs, com és la psicoanàlisi, que seria la primera que han determinat cap de la mirada manera es diferencia, es distancia del sentit literal d'un text i posa a pensar el discurs en si mateix, no? I quines són les significants que es connecten dins un discurs serien, al meu entendre, els elements basilars que fonamenten el que seria aquesta tradició, una tradició que posteriorment, dins de l'àmbit de la psicologia crítica, doncs ha tingut una gran importància, no? Ja fos en un àmbit, diguéssim, més vinculat al subjecte parlant, amb els estudis doncs d'etnometodologia, o en un àmbit ja més d'anàlisi crítica del discurs, arribant al que seria l'anàlisi de les ideologies, el que seria l'anàlisi dels que serien els repertoris interpretatius. El llenguatge, tal com ens ensenya l'anàlisi del discurs, no té només una funció denotativa, sinó també performativa, és un part constructor de la realitat, i en aquest sentit és important entendre com les paraules, l'ús dels discursos no són mai neutres. Per exemple, doncs, per parlar d'un tòpic que comú en el que ha sigut algunes de les dades en aquest seminari, com la violència de gènere, depèn de com definim aquesta violència, marcarà en quin discurs s'inscriu l'ús de la violència de gènere, o sigui, no per fer utilitzar un determinat, doncs, fer una determinada, doncs, construcció com violència de gènere, doncs podem pensar que això ja ens situa en un discurs feminista o no, en aquest sentit, com a vegades hem parlat del fet d'entendre la violència de gènere senzillament com aquella que es dona en un context privat i que implica la violència física d'un home contra una dona que manté una certa relació conjugal o de parentiu, doncs és una visió purament restrictiva d'aquesta violència de gènere. I això comportarà, alhora, ens segarà davant del que serien altres visions, altres fenòmens, altres esdeveniments que s'estan donant al voltant de la violència de gènere. Un tema en el qual, des del punt de vista més concret, com és la violència domèstica, que no és un punt de violència de gènere, sinó que seria una de les seves manifestacions, doncs, que també ens en parlarà. També, per acabar sobre el tema de la importància del discurs, és important entendre, doncs, que el discurs es relaciona amb un determinat text, i en un text poden emergir diferents discursos. O sigui, els discursos no hi ha una relació aplicativa de determinada manera entre el text i el discurs. De manera que, per exemple, es pot posar una nota d'actualitat. Com sabeu, aquest cap de setmana celebrarà a Barcelona l'anomenat Gay Pride, el que seria el dia d'alliberament gay, com li havia dit, lèsbic i transsexual, com li havien dit fins ara. El fet, doncs, que, per exemple, l'Ajuntament, el fet de que el que seria els transports municipals de Barcelona doncs s'apropien del concepte, doncs, de Gay Pride, doncs el que està fent és ressignificar aquest concepte, no? I en un principi, un concepte com Gay Pride, que neix en un context a San Francisco i altres llocs com una manera d'autoafirmació, doncs, d'una població minoritzada, doncs el que ens trobem és que s'utilitza com un reclam comercial, tal com ens marca el que seria els anuncis que podem veure a la web del carrer. Doncs, sense més dilacions, doncs us passo a Erika Waldman i el que seria doncs, la seva interessant ponència.
August is one. You can hear me? Yeah. Hello. I'm very pleased to be here and I want to thank you very much, Georgie, for that introduction. I hope I'll take up some of the themes that Georgie identified, though I don't think I'll do justice to the full range of issues that you put on the floor for us. And I want to thank Barbara Biglion very much for arranging this seminar and for arranging for me to give this last session in your Interdisciplinary Feminist Research Seminar. I'm going to talk about some work I've been doing over the last few years, particularly about open up a discussion about the relationship between feminist approaches and discursive approaches through the focus on some analysis of several texts that arises from a project that I've been involved with recently. I'm going to refer briefly to some aspects of the materials that I did send, the papers that I sent before, but if you haven't read it, it's not a problem. They're just there if you want to read them later on as well. So what I hope to cover, and what we'll do is I'll talk for a while and then open it up for discussion, then we'll have a break, and then hopefully I'll have got to a point where it's appropriate to have a break, and then if there's time, we'll be looking at some specific examples of text. And I want to say thank you for the translation and for the translators that make it possible for me to talk to you today, and also to put onto the agenda for discussion the fact that translation is itself a form of discourse analysis, I think, and that when you cross between languages, you're also reflecting upon language and acquiring precisely some of the distance to be able to comment on the functions of language that is part of what one does in a discourse analysis. So what I'm going to cover here, and very quickly I'm going to say, make some comments about the relationships between feminist and discursive approaches, at least as I have encountered them. And I'm going to apply these discussions to some particular text that was generated in a feminist action research project that I've been involved with, and try to take you through some of the various ways and resources I drew upon to make sense of some particular text. And if time, I want to show you in some more detail how one might apply some of these approaches to tease out different meanings from within this text and hopefully to generate your interpretations as well. So let me say something about feminist engagements with discursive work. Now, I have, as Julie said, been working around these discussions for quite some time, and so it was quite a challenge for me to try and think of how to tell you about how I see the relationships between feminist and discursive work, because they're interwoven in my own kind of intellectual biography. However, I do think that I do hold the position, and I think it's a fairly standard position amongst feminist researchers, that the feminist politics of a research, the feminism of research, arises from the politics that drives the research. The politics that informs the epistemological framework for the research, and therefore one can't say that any particular method or technique guarantees a feminist politics or not. It's really kind of what kind of research questions inform the project and that therefore drives the subscription to certain kinds of methodological approaches. So that's one kind of warning, because at some points, certainly in the UK, there was a sort of equation between feminist research and discursive research. And then there was a kind of separation of the ways, and I certainly would advocate a tactical engagement with any particular methodological approach for feminists, so that we shouldn't refuse any particular methodological approach either. It's the feminist politics that's important. And of course we can have debates about what we mean by feminist politics, but that's what we should be debating, rather than whether it's good or bad to use a particular method. Although, we may need to have that debate. But in any case, feminists, I think, because of this political engagement, are necessarily less respectful of disciplinary boundaries and more engaged with tactical appropriation of relevant theories and techniques, and we need to use what we can. So I would want to highlight that while there are significant overlaps between feminist and discursive approaches, there are some divergences as well. For me, at least, as a feminist researcher, I would want to say that I'm not committed to any particular model discourse analysis or any particular discursive approach. I'm more open to drawing on a range of approaches that seem to be helpful depending on what kind of text I'm working with. I have been drawn to some approaches more than others, but I would say that I'm quite eclectic in drawing across a range of techniques, if you like. Now, this is quite important, because there are some other feminist researchers who would say very clearly that they would only draw on one kind of discursive approach. But I'm kind of a bit more tactical, so I'm going to be trying to make some comments about a range of approaches. Just to give you a little context, when discursive approaches emerged in Britain, certainly in psychology, and I have a psychology background, it was initially assumed that all discursive research was feminist. Now, I think there were good reasons for this, because both feminist research and discursive research, as it emerged in psychology, were committed to destabilizing or questioning claims to truth. And both were offering constructionist accounts, in particular to challenge the sort of normative scientism of conventional psychology. And therefore, both were addressed to critiquing practices of power. So in conceptualizing or historicizing these relationships between feminist approaches and discursive approaches, I want to try and step outside or to sidestep questions of purity of origins, because I would say that both feminist and discursive approaches are derivative, in the sense that they are assembled from diverse sources that include, as Geordie said, linguistics, philosophy, and also social and political theory. And they're also not only a technique or a method, although I would say this is not to underestimate how there are some technical things that, or craft skills that one can learn through the practice of discourse analysis. Discursive approaches, at their very broadest, have been defined as a kind of sensitivity to language. And language in the sense of forms of language, language use, but also the interactional features of language, and taking language, a definition of language in its very broadest sense, as some kind of public conventional signifying or meaning system, which means that this is not simply a linguistic system, of course, but also visual and material. And many people know that debates about postmodernism that generated a lot of these constructionist debates, including discourse analysis in a way, started in discussions about material culture, like as in architecture. And feminist approaches to research share with discursive approaches an attention to language. And in particular, of course, in thinking about the relationships between gender and power, and a commitment, in the case of feminist work, to challenging and transforming inequalities. Now, I would want to now make a few comments about the politics of discursive approaches and, of course, the many varieties of discursive work that are now in circulation. I do think that there is a danger of over-attributing some kind of radical politics to discursive work. Discursive work, particularly in psychology, was hailed as being radical initially, and I think it was in its effects, but the greater an impact it had, the less political it became. And I do have some suspicions that the more technicist the more particular expertise that is generated around a discursive approach, the less political it becomes. But I think we have to consider all these issues to answer the key question of which, if any, kinds of discursive approaches could be said to support a feminist project. And I'm going to sort of offer a fairly agnostic, ambiguous answer to that. But as you'd see, I think this depends on how you understand feminist politics, and of course, what kind of feminism we're talking about. So the question of whether or not there could be or is a feminist discourse analysis is an interesting one, and one that has exercised feminists in the field, of course. There are claims that some kinds of discursive work are more or less aligned to or hostile to feminist approaches. That includes some British feminist researchers who would say that something like ethnomethodology or conversation analysis is definitely a feminist kind of discourse analysis. And I, in a book called Psychology, Discourse, Practice, was with my co-authors adopting a more Foucauldian, inflected variety of discourse analysis. So there are many of these kinds of discussions. Here I'm trying to say that one can draw across a range of approaches, depending on what your questions are. So I want to try and avoid polarizations around particular models of discourse analysis in my presentation here, to try and offer you some kind of perspective on what these approaches can offer to the analysis of some particular text. And as I said before, this is consistent with an understanding of feminist research where the feminist engagement informs the questions that are brought to the text. So I neither think that there is, nor that there isn't, a kind of feminist discourse analysis, as it's impossible to abstract this question away from particular forms of practice. Are we clear so far? It's too fast. Are we all right? So I sent to you a paper that arises from a previous project I was involved with that was about cultural discourses. I would say it was discourses around culture and the barriers that culture plays for minority ethnic women, or I'm going to call them minoritized women, in the Manchester area where I live, in terms of accessing domestic violence service provision. Now, this paper, I would say, exemplifies a discourse analysis, quite, I think for me, quite a complicated discourse analysis. Yet, because it was published in a social policy journal, the main social policy journal in the UK called Critical Social Policy, it doesn't explicitly present itself as a discourse analysis. And yet I would say, if you read it, I hope you would see that it was trying to dismantle some of the dominant meaning frameworks around how notions of culture are discussed in relation to gender and in relation to domestic violence. So that analysis comments on socially shared sets of assumptions that structure ways of representing or perceiving minority ethnic women who are trying to, or physicians having to, engage with services around domestic violence. Now, I would claim that this paper is an example of a kind of feminist discourse analysis on several grounds, partly because it was motivated to directly engage in exclusionary discourses that connect or disconnect structures of gender, racialization, and violence. What we did in analysing the material from this project that gave rise to this paper was take very seriously and develop a trope or a phrase generated by a black feminist researcher, Anne Phoenix, who talked about the representation of black women in the UK as being structured by either normalised absence or pathologised presence. That is, that black women were only talked about in social policy discourse when they were problematic, as a pathologised presence, and when their issues looked like everybody else's, that this wasn't commented on, so that they were invisible and normalised absence. And we took up this trope that Anne Phoenix generated in relation to, it was actually about black women as young mothers, to apply it to the ways in which minority ethnic women appear in relation to discourses around domestic violence service provision. So I would say that this was an example of a kind of feminist discourse analysis, because it was very much connecting with issues of practice and politics around the racialization and around violence against women. That was challenging both prevailing discourses around race and culture, and also prevailing feminist discourses. The prevailing feminist discourses were largely cultured mind, not understanding the ways in which racialization produces particular kinds of positions for women around violence, and also challenging the gender blind perspective on race and culture, and especially challenging key and quite damaging myths about particular groups of or communities being subject or being more likely to be violent towards women. And it was a piece of action research, because the project even changed some of the participants' perspectives on these issues. The participants were not only service providers, but service commissioners, and even some community-based voluntary sector organisations, because the project was crossing the black-white divide and working with different black and minority ethnic community groups working around domestic violence, precisely because we were not simply working around one minority ethnic group and their relation to domestic violence service provision, we were able to hear and counter the perspective that, let me try and rephrase this, each of those community groups, each of those minority groups face certain kinds of fears of fueling racism if they disclose violence or if, because we were working across those different groups and our participants knew that we were working with at least four minority ethnic groups, which were African and African Caribbean, South Asian, Jewish and Irish, that was in a way a kind of anti-racist intervention in prevailing discourses around domestic violence, precisely because there was a lot of surprise amongst even those community groups that the same kinds of myths about domestic violence were being circulated about each of those groups. So I would say this was a piece of action research in a number of ways, and it bridged the usual polarizations between those positioned as black or white, and in that sense could be seen as a kind of feminist discourse analysis of Rounds being an action research project that was linked to challenging and changing practice and grounded in an activist engagement with feminist and anti-racist campaigning groups. And you can ask me sort of more about the history of how it came about that I was involved in this project, if you like, but I'll just put that claim on the table for now. So it was not only feminist, but also discourse analysis, because it was concerned with elaborating the subtle ways dominant frameworks of meaning work by working closely with the words that were used by particular participants. And so we looking at the way the words worked, what kind of meanings were set in circulation, alongside a more structural and systemic analysis of institutions, the state, and of course contemporary geopolitical conditions, by which I mean things like the war against Iraq, that and even now, since 9/11, that dramatically affected the rates of disclosure of Muslim women to domestic violence services because of fears around Islamophobia in the UK. So that's some of the background and some of the prehistory to the text that I'm going to talk about now, which. Where I now want to try and make some comments about how an analysis might be generated to make sense of some quite difficult to analyze texts. So what, in the other paper you have a kind of finished analysis, here you have, here I'm presenting to you some strategies that might be used to try and begin to develop an analysis. Now this text that I'm going to be talking about was generated out of a subsequent project, and I'm going to leave a copy of the initial report over here. It was called Women Asylum Seekers from Pakistan, or WASP for short. Now this was an action research project that was based in a local law center, that is a legal rights service, that was concerned with advocacy and welfare rights. And I was the academic supervisor for this project, and in fact, I was the only academic involved, which is quite an interesting position to be. Now, those of you who know some English will already appreciate that the very name WASP, in having this as the acronym for our project, it's already at some kind of a discursive intervention because the term WASP is usually read as white Anglo-Saxon Protestant. In this case, it was women asylum seekers from Pakistan. You can't get much more of a contrast than that. Now, this is the initial report of the project here, which we called Safe to Return report, our transnational research project investigating Pakistani women's access to domestic violence and asylum support services in the UK and Pakistan. So it's a transnational project, this is quite important. So the second paper that I sent is a draft version of a chapter where I'm discussing some of the dilemmas in trying to discuss this work, which I'm having to, in some ways, curtail, shorten in telling you about it here. But of course, there are lots and lots of problems in saying anything about Pakistan and the situation of Pakistan and the situation of Pakistani women in relation to domestic violence in contemporary political situation that we were acutely aware of. And so in that chapter, I talk about the strategies that as a research team, we developed to try and address some of these ethical, political, and representational problems. So let me say a little bit more about the context of the text, because whenever you come to analyze a text, you need to know something about where it came from, how it was generated, and so on. So the project was a transnational project that investigated both Pakistani women's access to domestic violence support services in Pakistan and Pakistani women's access to asylum support services in the context of marital breakdown in the UK. So this is where in the UK, this is a bit complicated, but the Pakistani women in the UK whose residents relied upon their husband's residency would become asylum seekers in the UK if their marriage broke down due to domestic violence. And the project was specifically addressed to legal advisors and legal decision makers, that is, the people who were involved in preparing asylum claims to claim refugee status, and concerned with addressing what the British government, or the Home Office, calls the internal flight alternative, which is used to return Pakistani women in the UK to Pakistan. So if a woman, Pakistani woman, either in the UK, or who has come to the UK, is claiming they cannot go back to Pakistan because they would be subject to violence, the British government, like many other European governments, likes to say, well, it would be safe for you to go back to another part of Pakistan. You would be safe elsewhere in the same country. This is called the internal flight alternative. This is where you have to be a bit of a distance analyst, because you have to unravel these terms like internal flight. And that's why we called this project, in our final report, Safe to Return? Because we're arguing that the safety of returning is indeed questionable. So my focus here is on a piece of text that in fact we didn't discuss at all in this report, in the initial analysis that is presented in this report, which is the British Home Office response. They were participants, one of the many participants in our project, but we didn't really present any analysis of their response. And this was partly because, or mainly because, their response seemed very obvious and banal, so obvious and banal as to not seem worth analysing. And yet, after we'd rushed to complete a deadline and get something in print for the initial report, I thought that this very obviousness must exemplify precisely some of the tactics of banal exclusion, precisely because it seems so obvious, so banal, so commonsensical. It seemed common sense. No one was surprised by by what the Home Office said. It just seemed like it didn't merit any interpretation. And it's precisely at that point that a discourse analyst ought to get suspicious and ought to stop doing some further work, I think. So, just to clarify something about the Home Office. Of course, it's a key organ of the British state. One could argue that the practice of this kind of subsidiary state apparatus constitutes the state as much as reflects the state. Of course, in that sense, any text that it produces is performative. It must not simply reflect policy, but also enact it and in its very process. And in that sense, seeing how the Home Office reframes and engages with the questions we put to them becomes a micro analysis of state strategy, state tactics. In some ways, perhaps it's irrelevant what they said in their response, but the mere fact that we did get a response from them was interesting. Perhaps they felt they had to respond. Perhaps they felt they had to correct some other impression that they thought we would be having, getting from our other participants, and so on. Of course, it's particularly interesting to work with this material because we didn't have a specific respondent. So I'll just tell you a bit more about this text. In relation to particular models of textual or discourse analysis, and these include discourse analysis, sometimes called discursive psychology, and psychology critical discourse analysis. These are all particular brands, if you like, of discourse analysis, particular theorists associated with them. There's also narrative analysis that tends much more to the structure of prolonged text, looking at the order of topics and how they develop. Conversation analysis that focuses on the interaction in great detail, the turn-taking, and the micro-politics of the interaction, though that's usually applied to naturally occurring conversations, so-called, and so is less relevant here. And there are many more models of discourse analysis, so I'm just going to draw upon some features of those models in this analysis here. Now, discursive approaches in general rely upon a set of assumptions that include a commitment to attending to the interpretive character of the material. That means that one can't take any claim as factually true. All claims to factuality become a resource for analysis. And these claims can be interrogated instead in terms of how they accomplish their factuality. It invites an attention to textuality. We can say what kind of text generated with what kind of audience, with what kind of readership and circulation, who is included as an addressee, who is excluded from being addressed, and so on. And I think just to condense many debates and many theories together, I would say two key ideas about discursive approaches are as follows. The first one is the death of the author. I'm sure this will be very familiar to many of you. That is moving away from treating the author or the speaker as the entire originator and having access to all the meaning behind what they say. So it moves away from mentalist, humanist, and intentionalist claims. And in this case, it means moving beyond speculating about the particular Home Office officials who formulated this text. And the second key idea is about there being nothing outside the text. So all texts, including our own, are situated within context, a context that is social, material, political, cultural, historical. And so we have to remember that there are important discursive features as well as material conditions for understandings of concepts and ideas like immigration, asylum, violence, gender violence, and so on. Now, to come back to this text, the Home Office response was produced, as I said, as part of this project. Obviously, in some sense, they were a key respondent. They were a key respondent in a number of ways because, of course, we were hoping through the work of the project to change Home Office practice and policy in the very long run. But we had to invite them to comment and be a participant in our research as well. Their response took the form of an email reply to questions that, and they asked us to send the questions to them on email, and we responded. They declined to do either to meet face to face or to be interviewed on the telephone. Obviously, one can think about why that might have been. We wanted to make a written response. Now, clearly, there are already a number of methodological implications that followed from this, the fact that we have a written text rather than a record of a face-to-face interaction, verbal interaction, or a telephone interview. Of course, we don't know who exactly wrote this, or whether it was one individual or some kind of committee. It's likely that it was deliberated upon rather than spontaneously drafted. One could, I think, legitimately anticipate that, interpreted as being generated in a climate of suspicion rather than enthusiastic participation. And therefore, it being a written, crafted text, it's likely that areas of contention would be smoothed over or rendered less obvious and evident. And that means, in that context, that one has to think about the kind of analytical strategies that one would draw upon to interpret this text, including attending to absences as well as presences, thinking about how this particular response is similar or different to other responses we had as part of our corpus of material, and noticing the moves between more conversational and declarative or informative genres in the text. Now, we might say, why analyze this text, and why indeed draw discursive approaches to analyzing this text? Now, one reason why I think it was worth trying to analyze this text was precisely because it seemed so different from all the other texts that we generated as part of this project. It was dramatically different. It was different because of the way in which it didn't see that as being a problem about current asylum and immigration policy. This is not a surprise, this is the Home Office response, of course. But nevertheless, it was entirely different. It was remarkable just how consistently different this particular response was from all our other participants. And we interviewed a whole range of service providers and service users everywhere else, of course, in legal and asylum and domestic violence systems in the UK. And so the analytical challenge is to tease out why and how it achieves this formulation of there being no problem. Okay? And so I think this kind of text is interesting precisely to draw on discursive approaches as a tool to look closely at what this reveals of wider issues and debates. Now, as I said before, we didn't use this material within this report. And so this is a kind of supplementary analysis to the report that that I think also exemplifies wider issues that are drawn upon in that report. And of course, I am drawing upon that wider analysis in order to inform my interpretation of this text. I'm sure if you were to look at this text without knowing any of these other kind of issues and debates, you would generate a very different kind of analysis. And perhaps, you know, see what your responses are later. So the particular problematic that this text addresses, I think, is having to negotiate a central tension between women's rights, discussion of women's rights, and the ways in which women's rights connect with discussions about nationality, way in which, and there's a lot of feminist discussion about this, as I'm sure you know, in contemporary feminist theory, the woman-nation citizenship connection is a very central contemporary topic. In terms of British context right now, it's been very noticeable since Labour returned to power that there's been a double standard around domestic violence provision. The Labour government has been very active around domestic violence as a public order issue, but not sensitive to black and minority women's positioning. And of course, there is an immigration agenda that conflicts with a discussion around women's rights. So here, you know, in terms of broader political theory, politics, feminist politics drives this kind of analysis. It's important, I think, to connect with contemporary feminist analysis on how the idea of Europe was founded on the notion of European superiority to which claims about women's rights and women's freedoms have been central. And so we have exclusionary understandings of women where some women are accorded more rights than other women. So one could say, what kind of textual analysis does this call for, and why discourse analysis? Just to remind you again of some of what I said before, that discourse analysis is about unpicking claims to truth and to interrogate and make a problem out of things that look like they are not problematic. Supporting that is a climate of problematization. And in particular, I think it's useful to unpick the truth claims of official policy texts like this. And it's important, therefore, to help comment on and intervene in institutional practices, with the Home Office, as I said before, a key institutional agent involved in implementing and performing UK government policy. As a form of action research, well, I wouldn't claim that this particular analysis is going to change anything about the Home Office policy or British government policy, but I would say that the wider project is doing so as an instrument to support decision making. So the rationale then for a discursive approach here is that it's relevant for the analysis of practices of power, and it aims to tease out the kinds of gaps or fissures, tissues of meaning in the accomplishments of its statements as indicative of a particularly powerful regime of truth, the regime of the truth of refugee and asylum seekers. And in terms of models of discourse analysis, well, in my analysis of this text, I didn't draw so much on conversation analysis or ethnomethodology because this was not a transcript of spontaneous speech. But I did draw on some of those techniques to think about the sort of quasi or pseudo-conversational features of this text as indicative of the kind of relationship that was being set up between the speaker and the audience. points, and you'll see that in some of my subsequent extracts. Narrative analysis looks at structure and genre, and I did tend to that a bit. I drew on the work of some social psychologists who talk about ideological dilemmas, focusing on the form of argumentation involved in the text. And that is, in a way, a kind of relate to more contemporary discussions about formativity, how particular modes of argumentation constitute the text and speaker in particular ways as being reasonable or rational or unreasonable or irrational. And even visual analysis, because even a written text, even something as normative to us and usual as a transcript, as words written down on a page in black and white, of course, it has conventional systems that we are accustomed to, but there are still possible discrepancies to attend to and to comment on the format. Finally, I would say I drew upon a kind of Foucauldian approach in the sense that what is spoken can be assumed to conceal as well as reveal its truth. And of course, that the model, there is a model of the state that instead of thinking of the state as monolithic and static, it is constituted by its practices that are continuously reproduced. And of course, we could see the Home Office as a prime example of a kind of disciplinary power that also alerts us to the possibility of there being other ways of framing the issues that it is addressing. Because think about the kind of No Borders campaigns like No One Is Illegal. Those kind of counter discourses help us to reflect on what is being normalised or treated as an uncontestable truth by the Home Office. The theoretical connections we might draw upon here are about what inside or outside the text, how a specific text links to wider discursive practices and institutional practices, and of course, at its broadest, we were interested in this project in how domestic violence and immigration are, in a sense, a very good example, a prime example of the ways in which two kinds of power, bio power, disciplinary power, work together, with the state regulation of sexuality, in this case heterosexuality and intimacy, by a marriage connected with the flow of bodies across national borders. And it's crucial to focus on the mutual relationships between these two forms of power, biopower and disciplinary power, to think about and to address adequately the kinds of exclusions and injustices that happen for the position of minority ethnic women facing domestic violence, in which the immigrant woman is a key site by which to elaborate these discussions. So, I'm nearly at half time, but I would say, just in terms of the wider discourses about gender and asylum that I assume you will be familiar with, the previous model of the migrant and the asylum seeker was of a dependent, was of a single male, with women seen as dependents or appendages of those men. This image is now shifting, with the figure of the immigrant woman now being seen as constitutive of, according to contemporary debates in feminist theory, an elitist and exclusionary European identity, which of course contemporary discourses of liberating black women, brown women, as the phrase goes, from brown men, is part of the current discourse of the war against terror. It's part of the initial rationale. Now, the discussions about immigrant women entering, being a route by which men enter and gain immigration status within the UK is a big concern as well. So, what I have, let me see, I should probably stop that soon, should I? In 5 minutes, so I'll stop and just check with you, sense you're making of this. Just to clarify a little bit about institutions. So, the Home Office, we're treating the Home Office as a key informative. It's a complex organisation with many functions. It's the British government agency responsible for immigration issues, or it's rather a particular part of it is responsible for immigration issues. But as with other organisations, this organisation has been decentralised, and many of the functions of the British Home Office have been outsourced. So there are quite blurry boundaries. That is indistinct boundaries between what one could say are definitely government agencies and non-government agencies under contemporary neoliberalism. So it's interesting that the Home Office funds a lot of research, and sometimes the researchers, domestic violence researchers who talk about this research, talk at conferences as Home Office representatives. So I think it's important that we don't get into conspiracy theories about the Home Office, and we also don't forget that it's not easy to make absolute separations between state and non-state apparatuses. And this distribution of power can be unwieldy in quite interesting ways, even embarrassing ways for the government, as when it was discovered that the cleaners, the people who were cleaning the buildings of the Home Office, were actually illegal immigrants. Recently, the section of the Home Office that is responsible for immigration affairs was renamed from the Immigration and Nationality Directorate to the Border and Immigration Agency. And if I had more time, I would play with you and speculate about what's at stake in this name change. But you need to know this in terms of the kind of official terms that are used. So I don't think we can go back to this if you like, but I don't think it's central. It's trying to talk generally about discursive approaches, about feminist engagements with discursive approaches, about some work life, setting the context for the discussion of some particular text by talking about some previous work I've done and how discourse analysis might work with this kind of policy analysis of service provision around domestic violence. Now, you might want to ask me questions or raise big theoretical debates or disputes about discourse analysis of feminist theory or about things about this particular project. So let's open it up. Does anyone want to ask some questions, comments, clarification?
Hola, ¿qué tal? Muchas gracias, Erika, por toda la charla. Me llamo Pilar Albertín, nos conocemos un poco, creo, a través del correo, pero... No se lo presento. Si Simplemente quería hacerte una pregunta, tiene algo que ver, pero no fundamentalmente con el análisis del discurso. Y es un poco el término de raza. ¿Por qué lo utilizas? La pregunta igual es simple, pero no sé, ¿no? ¿Por qué lo utilizas y cómo lo utilizas en tu análisis y en tu, bueno, en tu construcción de, del texto, del discurso? Simplemente eso.
Well, mostly, thank you. Hello, Pilar. It's good to see you. I use the term race, in inverted commas. Mostly I think I've used the term racialization. This is an important discursive intervention in discourse around race, you could say. Parallels our subsequent invention of the term minoritization. So race, as you know, is a biological, a theory of biological differences between different groups of people. It's a racist fiction. However, people use the term race in inverted commas to describe what are understood to be some kind of observable, sometimes cultural differences between groups of people. And it often can